this is a symposium that you're going to attend today that was actually organized in cooperation between the Danish Embassy and the Hebrew University, who very generously offered to host and co-coordinate and help us plan this international symposium on Holocaust and the rescue of the Danish Jewry. Last autumn, we commemorated the 75th anniversary of the rescue of the Danish Jews during World War II. More than 7,000 Jews were saved from Holocaust in the month of October 1943, the vast majority of the Danish Jews that actually were in Denmark at the time. They were generously hosted by Sweden until the end of World War II. We commemorated the ones that actually were rescued, but also the ones that were killed or died during the attempt to flight, and those also who were deported to Theresienstadt, most of them actually returning back to Denmark after or at the very end of World War II, but unfortunately some perished due to illness and very harsh conditions in Theresienstadt. Last autumn, Israel and Denmark came together in this commemoration of the 75th anniversary. And I think it's very fair to say that the rescue constitutes a very important historic foundation between Danes and Jews, between Denmark and Israel. And that it also still resonates very widely today. It has created a special bond between our peoples. And that's why President Ruven Rivlin accepted the invitation of the Danish Prime Minister Lars Løkke Rasmussen to go to Denmark and commemorate this event in the Church of Gilleleje on the northern shores of Zealand and in the synagogue, the great synagogue in Copenhagen. And that's why the President Ruven Rivlin afterwards hosted here a commemorative event at his residence in cooperation also with the Danish government. Many people have described to me that they saw and still see the rescue of the Danish Jews to Sweden as a light in darkness, a small shining hope in an ocean of darkness, of Holocaust. People who have survived the Holocaust and their relatives tell these stories over and over again, and Danish Jews who were saved and their relatives also come telling that story. I believe that the remembrance of the Holocaust and of the rescue of the Danish Jews actually serve as a reminder to the world of the evil that can prevail if basic fundamental respect for human rights is disregarded. Advancing awareness on the Holocaust goes hand in hand with also raising awareness on fundamental rights, because the history of Holocaust shows the consequences of gradual and increasing denial of human rights. The rescue of the Danish Jews, on the other hand, is among other things the story of the emphasis that was made in the development of the Danish democracy in the early parts of last century and the years preceding Holocaust, on creating a general awareness in the Danish population that a violation against the individual was also a risk to the entire society. The purpose of today's symposium is to understand and discuss the rescue of the Danish Jews in a broader perspective, in the perspective of protection of human rights and understanding how far we have come after Holocaust in building international safeguards to prevent grave violations of human rights to happen. So first of all, to discuss and listen to the speakers here, to which lessons we have learned from the rescue of the Danish Jewry from Holocaust and from the signs of warning preceding the Holocaust in countries across Europe. And discuss and understand in what way these lessons still are relevant vis-a-vis the challenges we face in the world of today, related, among other things, to racism, xenophobia, anti-Semitism, challenges that we are still confronted with throughout the world. After World War II, we have in many ways come a very long way in building international institutions and agreeing on and adopting human rights conventions to protect the basic human rights of citizens. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights was first and foremost the statement of an international agreement on the fundamental observation that human rights, that human beings have rights by virtue of being exactly that, human, and that they are universal, and that there are universal limits to how bad states can treat their own citizens. So together with the Nuremberg trials of the Nazi war criminals in 1945 to 1946, and the adoption of the Convention on Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide in 1948, the Universal Declaration was a clear statement that governments' conduct vis-à-vis their own citizens was no longer a purely domestic matter in respect of which others were not entitled to intervene. We'll also today discuss how far we have actually come with this human rights framework and with the international cooperation on protecting human rights and preventing atrocities. Finally, if this was all not enough, we'll also expect this symposium to reflect on what we as citizens and as states and as international community can do to strengthen our joint efforts to develop policies, to develop tools that can prevent grave violations of human rights in the future. We live in a world with many changes. We live in a world where power shifts from west to east, and global trends of increasing nationalism and populism cause a new pressure on human rights. To do all that, we have invited four very prominent scholars as speakers today. So we are very, very privileged to have you here. And the people that I'll be presenting also when they'll be on the floor here is Dr.Phil Bo Lidegaard, journalist Anders Jerichow, Professor Yehuda Bauer, and Professor Mordechai Kremnitzer. But this would not have been the same, didn't we have an audience? So welcome also to the audience that consists of diplomats, scholars, people from the universities, Danes living in Israel, Jewish institutions in Israel, and friends of Danish, Jewish, Israeli, Denmark cooperation. Welcome to you all, and we look forward to some interesting hours with you ahead. Then I'd like to turn to the first speaker of this afternoon, who is Dr.Phil Bo Lidegaard. He's a Danish historian, he's an author, he's a former colleague, a diplomat, and he's former editor-in-chief of the daily newspaper Politiken. Bo Lidegaard is one of the recent Danish writers on the history of the rescue of the Danish Jews. He has made extensive and intensive historical research on the rescue. And he's going to speak to you today about the analysis and understanding what actually made the rescue of the Danish Jews possible, try to highlight and contextualize the importance of a number of factors and efforts which contributed to making the rescue from Denmark possible. Welcome, Bo, from Denmark to Israel, and welcome here on the podium.
Thank you so much. Thank you to the Danish Embassy, and thank you to the European Forum here at the Hebrew University for organizing this symposium and indeed for inviting me to address you. It's an humbling experience to be here today, and I shall not try to answer all the questions that you have set up for the symposium, but only to address the somewhat more restricted but still complicated question, what made actually the rescue possible, what were the ingredients for this outstanding exception from the general pattern of the Holocaust. And what I'm going to say on that subject is a very brief resume of my book published a couple of years back, Countrymen. It came out with Knopf in New York and has been published in 12 countries as an attempt to understand the events in October of 1943 on the premise of the events at the time. It is almost exclusively based on written sources, diaries, documents, communication from those days. So I have tried to exclude from both my mind and from the source material anything that has been influenced by what we have since found out and know about the Holocaust. This is an attempt to reconstruct, as it were, events based on the premise of 1943. And I will try to answer the question, which is, the question is very simple. What made the rescue of the Danish Jews possible? And I'll try to answer this in 10 brief points. And then there will be later a debate, and of course you are welcome to both to disagree and to ask questions. But here is my answer in 10 points. And the headline of that answer is that the Danish Jews survived thanks to the policy pursued by the Danish government, the main Danish political parties and administration and mainstream civil society in the lead up to World War II and indeed during the German occupation of Denmark, which took place in April, 9th April 1940, and thus was sort of 3.5 years into the occupation when these events took place. This actually is a quite provoking statement that the answer is to be found in a policy that was pursued over basically a decade, the preceding decade. But I'll try to make the argument that though this is a provocative statement, it is still right. So, my first point is the very brief outline of the Danish response to events in Europe in the 30s. There was a very early, a very considerate, and a very deep understanding in the Danish political establishment of what happened in Europe at a quite strategic and fundamental level. To me, even today, it is very hard, but also in a way very encouraging to read how deeply central political forces understood what was unfolding and the implication of that. In the Danish situation and context, this was very much driven by a leading member of the governing Labour Party, the political spokesman of the party, who happened to be a philosopher, a scholar, an academia, who had been studying both the Bolshevik Revolution, the Mussolini march on Rome in 22, and of course very much the Nazi accession to power in Germany. And Mr. Hartwig Frisch, this was his name, was both extremely knowledgeable, but he was also a very centrally placed politician within the majority government. And he published in 1933, the same year Hitler acceded to power, a major book called Plague Over Europe, in which he tried to analyze the nature of Bolshevism, fascism, and Nazism. And his main thesis was that whereas these phenomena were at each their side of the political spectrum, and as they framed each other as their main mutual enemies, they really had much more in common than met the eye and were essentially free expressions of the same totalitarian threat. Opposing and threatening democracy. And his argument then was that as these three are all parts of the same threat, we, the Democrats, cannot ally ourselves with either of them and win over the others. So the ever-tempting alliance for labor with the communists against fascism and Nazism was a trap, as communism was as threatening to democracy as was fascism and Nazism. And vice versa, the call from the extreme right to ally against communism was another trap, because inherently in fascism and the Nazism were values that were fundamentally contradictory to democracy. And this led Hartwig Frisch to argue that the idea that we, Denmark, could stop this threat, could win against it by trying to build a military defense, was not only illusory because Germany was basically on the other side of a flat border and a flat land with 80 million against 4 million, and any idea that we could build a military resistance against that was simply missing the point. His point was more fundamentally that the real threat was not the Wehrmacht, was not the army of the Third Reich, it was the ideas underlying Nazism. And where the real front line was to avoid these ideas, these free ideologies, to take root in the Danish population. The inner enemy was much more dangerous than the outer, and the battle line was not at the Danish border to Germany, it was where democracy were challenged by the communists and the fascists and the Nazis internally. And this then led him to argue that we, the government, had to build a defense that would, and he framed this in basically in the terms I'm now summarizing them to you, we had to build a defense that took the nation as its basis. What went wrong for our comrades, he wrote, in the SPD, in the German Social Democracy, and the reason why they lost to the Nazis was that they took an international platform, leaving the national platform to the Nazis. In Germany, it became an attack on being German when you attack the Nazis, whereas the Nazis could claim that being a good German equaled being a Nazi. And Hartwig Frisch wrote, if we, the Social Democrats, if we allow that national platform in the hands of the Nazis, or the right wing, I think actually he said, we can never win it back, because we can never attack them from the right side. We have to conquer the national platform, and we do that by creating a mental link between being Danish, wanting to defend Denmark, and wanting to defend democracy. So the social democracy started from 33 to use the words Danish and democracy as almost synonymous. Being Danish meant being a Democrat meant being Danish. Anyone putting democracy into question were labeled un-Danish. And this made it excessively difficult for the Nazis and for the communists to establish a national political platform, and the government, which was a coalition government between the Labour and the Centrist Party, managed to, in the following years, 45, 35, 6, 7, to force the two main right-wing democratic parties into actually adopting this strategy, and those four parties constituting by far the center in Danish politics over the 30s developed this as their common line of defense. If you were Danish, you were a Democrat. If you attacked democracy, which of course was very common in Europe at this time, if you attacked democracy, you were outside the national consensus, you were un-Danish, you were representing something alien to the Danish nation. And the effect of this strategy, which was actually, in political terms, extremely successful, was that at no point in any election in the 30s did the anti-democratic forces in Denmark, represented by the Nazis and the communists, achieve more than jointly 4% at any election. More or less with equal representation, 2% each. And as it were, we also held elections during the war, during the occupation. And at that election, they received even less. The communists, of course, because they were outlawed. And the Nazis, what to their surprise, less than 2% of the vote. So this strategy was extremely successful. And it was part of it that there was a debate in the Danish parliament as late as early 39 about the emerging signs of antisemitism in Denmark. And here I'm not talking about the prevailing stereotypes about Jews, but the emergence of the small fraction of Danish Nazis beginning to disseminate real anti-Semitic propaganda inspired from Germany. And in January of 39, legislation was passed in the Danish parliament outlawing, making anti-Semitism or racist propaganda illegal. There was a debate. I still love to quote the debate. The right-wing parties questioned whether this was not too deep a compromise on the freedom of speech, and whether it was not better to take the discussion about this problem in the public rather than outlawing something that should be dealt with as part of the general political debate, normally a winning proposition in the Danish parliament. And the Minister of Justice made a memorable intervention where he said that he would recommend the honored members of the parliament opposing this legislation to actually read Herr Hitler's Mein Kampf and what was written there. And he quoted central quotations from Mein Kampf from the rostrum and said, "I don't think that this leaves any doubt that this legislation is necessary. But if you do not think it is necessary still, I would recommend you then to," and I quote, and he found the latest speech of Dr. Goebbels and read aloud what he said about Jews and said, "I think this will prove to you that this legislation is not only warranted, but absolutely necessary." and it was passed and enforced also during the German occupation of Denmark. So there was this very clear mindset, and this was the first precondition. This, of course, did not entail a Danish crusade against Nazism or attempts to help the victims of Nazism in Germany, Austria, and other places. It was a purely national strategy for national survival. Denmark was absolutely in no mood to take issue with Germany. And in the quotation I just made of the Danish Minister of Justice, reading from Mein Kampf and reading quotations of Goebbels, he added, as a senior member of the government, "I'm not passing judgment of how these things are handled in other countries. I'm advising you, fellow parliamentarians, on how to handle these issues in this country." So there was no attempt to sort of take issue with the Reich, and actually the stronger the Nazis established themselves in the Third Reich, the more touchy they became on any criticism, and the stronger the Danish government leaned over the press not to report too much about what was happening in Germany. There was a very large measure of self-censorship on the part of Denmark in not provoking the Nazis in the neighboring Germany. And there was in Denmark, as in literally all the countries surrounding Germany, a very strict legislation towards migrants and refugees trying to escape from the Reich. And as this audience will be completely familiar with, it was actually not only possible but encouraged for German Jews to travel out of Germany until very late. The difficulty for the vast majority of German Jews was that they had no opportunity, because it took a visa typically to the US, and only a minority could get that. And Denmark, like most other neighboring countries, the greater the number of refugees, the more restricted the access to actually enter Denmark. And when the war broke out, only some thousand Germans had actually ended up in Denmark. There was a stream of refugees coming through Denmark, but only if they had visa to proceed to other countries. So there was no heroic, there was no humanitarian, there was no attempt to save people, but there was a deliberate attempt to save Denmark, and that included the Jews that lived here, or lived in Denmark, both those who had been living there for a long time and those who had arrived much more recently. So this takes us then up to April 9, 1940, which was the day the Germans attacked Denmark. The expectation of the political establishment was that by being so submissive to Germany, by absolutely providing no provocation, by more than hinting that if Germany needed military points of entry on Danish territory, that was absolutely something we could discuss, by not mobilizing, by being absolutely clear that Denmark would never take sides with the enemies of the Reich, that by all these measures Denmark would actually not be occupied but would be able to remain neutral as we had been during the First World War, which was of course in the minds of the leading politicians, who all of them had actually been part of the governing coalition also during the First World War. So the strategy was clearly to repeat what was seen from a Danish perspective, the success of standing outside the First World War. So the all-out German attack on Denmark came as a surprise. The alliance between Hitler and Stalin provoking the war in September the year before did not come as a surprise. It was exactly as the Danish government had expected, but the attack on Denmark came as a surprise, and it came as an even greater surprise that the first thing the Germans did when they attacked 8 different places in Denmark at the same time, including in the middle of Copenhagen, was to hand over an ultimatum that no one in Denmark had anticipated, and which was also quite unique, because what the Wehrmacht said was that they would grant Denmark free guarantees if Denmark would not defend itself. First, it would keep on respecting our neutrality. Second, it would not interfere in our internal political affairs, meaning it would not impose a Nazi government on the country or Nazi laws. And three, and perhaps to the then government, most importantly, it would not question the Danish-German border, which, like all other of the borders, were a product of Versailles, and this was actually the only border of Germany that was not challenged by Hitler. So the government was in a position where it had these three promises, as they were known, from Germany, and on the other side, they had literally the German army standing in the middle of Copenhagen, and absolutely no chance of raising or holding any part of the country. So the government reluctantly, but still, decided to form a broad-based national government with the four parties, the four democratic parties, and to take responsibility for the situation in the country under the German protection, as it was dubbed. And this situation under which Danish authorities, the democratic Danish government, the parliament, the king, the judiciary, remained in place, that was fundamentally in place throughout the entire occupation. There was a major shift in 43, but fundamentally this situation remained untouched over the occupation, and that meant, and this is very hard for anyone who haven't been part of Danish history to understand, that throughout most of the occupation, the Danish government was constituted by the elected politicians. None of them had any sympathy for Nazism. They were actually the ones who had designed the strategy to oppose Nazism. They were representing the parties supported by 96% of the electorate. They were supported by the king. Not one single prominent Danish politician left the country to represent an alternative. There was no resistance until 43 of any measure. So this was basically the national unity strategy, and it involved a sequence of concessions to the Germans, who of course from 10 April started to compromise the free promises and started to infringe of Danish sovereignty, with the Danish government trying to hang on to as much Danish sovereignty as you can conceivably hang on to when you're actually occupied by a Nazi army. So the degree to which this was defendable from a moral point of view has been disputed since then, from the very first day. Every single compromise and concession made has been disputed from they were made until this day. And there has been, and still are, in Denmark, an ongoing discussion on whether you can defend democracy by actually compromising it. Those who did it, the governments at the time, had the fundamental position that it was better to be ruled by people who were democrats and to preserve Danish society than to leave it to the Nazis. And of course, the small Nazi party, Danish Nazi party, was all willing to take over the government and to do as they did in Norway, to impose Nazi legislation from above, based on a local party and the strength of the occupation forces. That's a different story, and the moral choices that entailed is also a different story. But what is clear is that the strategy of the government was complete continuation of the strategy pursued since 1933, defend the core democratic values of society. As the Prime Minister, the Labour leader, the longest standing Danish Prime Minister under democracy, Mr. Stauning, framed it, it is about holding back, keeping time going, and avoid the big disaster. And the big disaster, of course, would be a Nazi takeover of the Danish society. It soon turned out that just as the Germans, of course, could press, and they did, for compromises, the Danish side, to a surprising degree, also had leverage. And the leverage was that this example of how beautifully a country could submit itself under German occupation was hailed by Hitler as a very good example of Neu-Europa, of how the European landscape should unfold once the war was over and the Germans had established its rule over Europe. So maintaining this situation was politically important to Germany. Over time, but this was more later in the war, it also became important because of the provisions of agricultural products from Denmark. But the threat of the government to resign had some impact, some leverage. And the drama of the occupation in Denmark was the negotiation between these two very unequal forces, the German occupation forces and the Danish government, negotiating and cooperating throughout 5 years on the conditions of the occupation in Denmark. Very few lines were held throughout, but some were held. One was no Nazi participation in the government, and the other was no special legislation for Danish Jews. And this last point was a recurrent issue in the Danish-German cooperation or negotiation. And we had on record, we have on record, between 5 and 10 documented instances where a dialogue took place along the lines of, well, Mr. Minister, a German high-ranking official in Berlin or in Copenhagen, well, Mr. Minister, Danish Prime Minister, Danish Finance Minister, Danish National Governor of the National Bank, we also have to address the issue or the problem of the Danish Jews. And it's about time that we begin addressing this issue. Danish answer, as you well know, Herr, whatever, we don't have a Jewish problem in Denmark. And besides, we have no knowledge from the government side of who are Jewish and who are not Jewish. It's not an issue under Danish law. No, we do understand that that is your position. And what we want is not anything dangerous. We just want to be sure who are Jewish and who are not Jewish. And an easy way of doing it, and we have done this throughout Europe, is to stamp the identity cards of Jewish citizens with a J. Doesn't harm anyone. It's just a precautionary measure for all of us to know who they are. So this shouldn't cause any problem for you. And the Danish authorities said, yeah, well, it actually does cause a problem because it's unconstitutional. In the Danish constitution, we don't distinguish between different kinds of citizens. So if you have a citizen identity card, there are not two different kinds. So we cannot single out. And besides, we don't have a registry. But you could surely make one if you really wanted to. No, we can't. Because we don't have any legal measures to do so. And this went back and forth and on, and you all know the history that developed into a myth of the Danish king, and underlying the myth of the Danish king is a real historic event from 42, when the prime minister is making his weekly reporting to the Danish king, and he's reporting to the king. They have been there again, and they are now proposing that we should introduce the yellow star for all Danish Jews to wear. The king asks, but what did you answer? And the prime minister says, we said, of course, that we will not do it. It cannot do it under Danish law, and we refused. And the king closes the discussion saying, you have my full support. And if they finally prevail, I guess we will all have to wear it. And this filtrated into the Swedish press, and there was a cartoon with the king then wearing the star, and that filtrated into the American press, and it came to the Danish king riding the streets of Copenhagen, which he did, in his uniform, which he did, with the yellow star, which he didn't, because no one in Denmark were imposed to wear the yellow star. This meant that when the Norwegian Jews were deported in the fall of 42, the Danish Jews were still living a completely normal life in Denmark. When you read diaries from ordinary Jewish families, and this is very much what my book is based on, it is very clear that whereas there is, of course, a degree of uneasiness about what they hear, there is nothing like a recognition of what's going on. Nothing has stunned me more in doing this book than the degree to which we are all prone not to believe what we don't want to believe, and not to hear what we don't want to hear, and not to understand what is really inconvenient for us to understand. And my proposition is that no one in Denmark, except perhaps a few civil servants, I'll come back to them, understood even in the fall of 43, what was going on. They of course understood that being deported to Germany was not a pleasant thing. It was absolutely not something anyone wanted. But what it entailed, they had no idea. No idea. So, for a number of reasons, in August of 43, the Danish government was confronted by German demand to actually, for the first time, introduce German punishment for sabotage. At this point, resistance had begun. Very spread, not organized, but still. That was something the politicians could not take responsibility for. Besides, everyone at this point began to think that the war would soon be over, and it became more and more burdensome for the politicians to take responsibility. So at the end of August, the government resigned. They refused to give this one more concession. They resigned. The king refused to accept the recognition, basically putting a lock on the Danish constitution, which meant that no other government could be nominated. The Germans took power. A state of emergency was introduced. the Danish army and was dissolved, and partly arrested, and the country was in a state of emergency. And in this situation, finally, the German occupation force decided to move against the Danish Jews. And you have to understand here that whereas in the beginning, the supreme representatives of the Reich were actually civilians in Denmark, at this point, the leading German representative, the Reichskommissar, Dr. Werner Best, was a very high-ranking Gestapo, a Nazi officer. He was at one point number three in SS. He was a close ally of Heinrich Himmler. He had been in Poland in 39. He had been in Paris, in France, in 40. He knew exactly. He had been part of it. He was a convinced, active Nazi, part of the inner circle. And when he was posted to Denmark, directly ordered by Hitler, he had two orders, two achievements received directly from the Führer. One, maintain the peaceful occupation and solve the Jewish problem in Denmark. Werner Best was, besides being a convinced Nazi, he was also a very skillful bureaucrat and diplomat. And he realized very early on that those two objectives were mutually exclusive, because the reaction in the Danish public of an action against the Jews would most likely compromise the peaceful occupation. So he was trying very hard to find a way, and he himself recommended to Hitler, now that we have the state of emergency and the Wehrmacht in command, so it's not the SS, but the Wehrmacht, let's get this dirty business over and done with. Hitler issued the order, but notably in a form where he, according to Ribbentrop, who took the order, said in issuing the order to round up the Danish Jews, Hitler, try to do it in a way that doesn't offend the Danes too much. So even at that level, there was a recognition that this would not be popular with the Danish public. There was no government, no organized resistance, no press. Werner Best knew that there had been rumors again and again about an action against the Danish Jews, and basically no one believed it. So he, or, and this is a delicate, controversial point, his next in command, Mr. Dukwitsch, I believe Werner Best himself.
Could you please speak into the microphone?
Sorry, I believe that the idea of issuing a very authoritative warning was agreed between the two leading Nazis in Denmark, Werner Best and his next command, and Dukwitsch, his next in command, arranged the meeting with the leading social democratic labor politicians who had gone into hiding but still were accessible, telling them, in 3 days' time, we will raid the Danish Jews and deport them. And then that led to this situation where there was a 2-3 days warning from the very highest echelons of society that the action was coming, spreading throughout both the government system or the bureaucratic system and within the Jewish families and organizations, and leading to a very large part of the Danish Jews and Jews living in Denmark literally sinking into the rest of society in the days before the action actually took place on 1st of October, 43. And there are countless accounts of how this happened, and I'll quote but one, which is both a little bit funny, if one can, anything of this sort can be funny, but also to illustrate the very extraordinary circumstances under which this happened. And it happened actually at the paper at which Anna's sitting there is working, and which I was editing at the very central square in Copenhagen. And this is again based on a diary written those same days. Two of the editors are standing in the windows looking down at the central square and say, have you seen, one says to the other, have you seen all these Jewish families? Now they really think they are after them. Have you seen them? They are, I mean, whole families with children and suitcases, they're all trying to flee. Why are they fleeing? Nothing will happen. And they were sort of joking about it. And then one says to the other, I thought actually you were half Jewish. Me? Oh my God, I'll run out. And he ran it out and figures out that this is actually, and 10 minutes later, he is there with his wife, seeking refuge with fellow Danes. So when the raid was actually carried out 2 days later, most had gone with neighbors, with colleagues, with family members, and only, if only is an appropriate word, some 400 were found and deported to Theresienstadt. The rest sunk into society. And what is amazing, and this is basically the answer to the question, was that the way they sunk into society was not by way of the resistance. It was not by way of the government. It was not by way of, you know, a call to the public to help. It was by way of completely ordinary citizens saying, we cannot allow this to happen. This is not acceptable. So people did what they could, from closing their eyes to driving the bus to taking them into the hospital or the basement or the guest room or the cellar. And the entire society absorbed these people. And for many Danes, that situation became the first time they really realized what was at stake. And it's of course very hard to make a general assessment why people did this, why the bus driver, why the train driver, why the doctor, why the priest, why the school teacher acted as they did, because of course there was no statement, there was no declaration, there was no words put to it. But there is a way still to answer the question, and this is what happened in civil society organizations, and we have a lot of them in Denmark, we did. The Confederation of Danish Women, the Confederation of Danish Industry, the trade unions, Danish Farmers Organization, Danish Students, Gym Club, the configuration of Danish deans, and so on and so forth. A very large number of these civil society organizations, in those 2 days preceding the action, convened an emergency meeting of their supreme body. They wrote a letter or a petition to Werner Best. And when you read these petitions, which were not coordinated, there is a general theme. They will go like this. Sehr geehrtet, Dr. Best, it has come to our knowledge that you are planning an action against our fellow citizens, our countrymen. The word Jew was never mentioned. Fellow citizens, countrymen, we must impose on you how deeply this will offend our sense of justice and attack the deepest values of the Danish society. And some wrote, some variations, to us, to the Confederation of Danish Women, this will be a graver violation of Denmark than the fact that you have occupied our country. You are violating our society, and it will be very hard for us to ever become friends again. Please don't. The king wrote. And this, of course, reinforced the perception Best had already that this was a critical moment to deliver on his promise of the peace occupation. So the action took place in the evening. It was a one-off. Those who were caught were deported. The rest disappeared, and in the morning, Best rode back, mission accomplished. Denmark is in Judent, Judenfrei. And he, of course, knew that there were 7,000 Jews not accounted for, but they were gone. So the problem has been solved. And in the following 2-3 weeks, they were shipped over from all the small harbors at the coast to Sweden, which critically, in the morning, the Saturday morning, the action was the night between Friday and Saturday, issued over the radio for the first time during the war a statement saying, again, the word Jew were not mentioned, all Danish refugees are welcome. And this meant that everyone housing a Jewish family knew that if they could only make it to the coast, find someone in the family, find someone who knew someone who had a boat or knew a fisherman, and they could ship these over, the Swedes would be there to take care. So the actual exodus was not, it was extremely dramatic because everyone felt, the helpers, the refugees, all felt that Gestapo and the Germans were at their heels. So accidents happened, suicides happened, but essentially very few were caught during the escape. Those who were caught were the ones who, for one reason or another, were at home when the Gestapo knocked on the door. So this ended up with some 400 being arrested that night. Over the coming days and week, a small number, additional number were deported. I think the total figure deported to Theresienstadt was 481. Theresienstadt, as you will know, most of you, was a transition camp to Auschwitz. But the Danish authorities, from the following day, made demarches in Berlin, in Copenhagen, insisting to be in contact with every single Jew who were deported from Denmark, and created, frankly, a nuisance to the extent that we want to send a package to this person who's sick and needs this medicine, we want to send this, we want, this was a failure, a mistake, even according to your own rule, this person must be sent back, and so on and so forth. Where are they? Can we communicate? Can we send doctors? Can we send the Red Cross? And this ended up in a promise that no one would be, as it was put, sent on. And the Danish Jews stayed in Theresienstadt. Some of those, a little below 500, approximately 50 perished in Theresienstadt because of the conditions there, the hard work and so on and forth, but none of them were actually deported. And days before the final collapse of the Reich, the white buses organized in a joint Scandinavian effort managed to drive all the way down to Theresienstadt and get them aboard the white buses and drive them up through Denmark and into Sweden. So by far the majority of those deported also came back. So this is a story that, or a question that in my interpretation can only be answered by referring to this deliberate effort and successful effort to build a recognition and a cohesion in society and a consciousness that once you go down this road, the entire society is at risk, and the real essence of defending your society is not to defend the border, it is to defend the democracy and the values on which it is built. I can find no other explanation. It is controversial, and it came at a price. that is absolutely disputable, because this would not have been possible without the cooperation and the acceptance of what the Germans were during the occupation. But this is, in my mind, the answer. Thank you so much for the attention.
Thank you very much, Bo, for this very, very interesting introduction to your interpretation of the reasons why we actually succeeded in having all the Danish Jews rescued.